Hey, good afternoon to everybody. Thanks for inviting me. I am Angela Caruso and I work at Istituto Superiore di Sanità in Italy. And our main research investigates ultrasonic vocalizations as model of social communication in neurodevelopmental conditions. And in particular, we are focused on testing ultrasonic communication and social behaviors in animal models of autism spectrum disorders. As the previous speaker told us, autism spectrum is a heterogeneous group of neurodevelopmental disorders characterized by two main core symptoms: impaired social communication and interaction and restricted repetitive behavior very, very early. In addition to core symptoms, also co-occurring conditions such as language impairment, intellectual disability, genetic disorders, medical comorbidities, and behavioral comorbidities are very, very, very common in autism and can overlap with other neurodevelopmental conditions. Actually, it is estimated that the prevalence of autism is one child over 68, and the ratio boy-girls is approximately 4 to 1. And currently, we know that the concordance is 60-80% in monozygotic twins and 20-30% in dizygotic twins, and the occurrence in siblings of children with autism is 18%. And the linkage genetic association studies suggest there are a lot of genes associated with autism, such as orexin, neuroleukin, Shanks, synapsin, and also with other comorbid neurodevelopmental conditions. And here we can see that 100 and 100 genes are considered as potential risk factor of autism. The genetic animal model can be helped to understand the role of each one in the pathogenesis of autism. And the strategy for testing this genetic hypothesis about the cause of autism could be represented with this slide through different steps. First of all, we have to generate a candidate gene mutant mouse, carry on a behavioral phenotyping, and trace a developmental trajectory, and to study the biological mechanism underlying the mutant genes, and hopefully apply a clinical therapeutic intervention in a subject with autism. But why are mouse models so useful for us? Because mice are social species and they have a wide range of social behaviors, such as ultrasonic vocalizations. And they can emit ultrasonic vocalization during different social contexts during life. In particular, during the interaction mother-pup, we can measure the distress calls when we separate pups from their mothers and siblings during the first 2 postnatal weeks for about 3 minutes, or during adult social contest. We can carry out actually a quantitative and a qualitative analysis of ultrasonic vocalization. For the quantitative analysis, we can consider the number, the duration of calls, mean fundamental frequency, and the mean pickup amplitude of each call. Here we can see an example of spectrogram that allow us to visualize the sound, in which the x-axis represents the times, and the y-axis represent the frequency, and the color the amplitude. However, to better characterize mice vocal repertoire, in our laboratory, in our group, we have classified mouse calls in 10 categories defined according to their internal frequency changes or duration or spectrographic shapes. And in particular, we have classified them as chevron, When the color is, seems an inverted U shape identified by a continuous increase in pitch followed by the decrease that is at least 6 kHz. Or are structured when they don't have a defined structure. Upward, when call exhibit a continuous increase in pitch with a terminal frequency at least 6 kHz higher than the frequency at the beginning. Downward, when the call exhibits a decrease in pitch with a terminal dominant frequency at least 6 kHz lower than the frequency at the beginning. Complex. When we have just one call element that contains two or more changes in pitch. Short call when they are shorter than 5 milliseconds. Sorry. Or two component. When the call consists of two sound components, a main one, usually a flat or a downward component with an additional point fragment toward the ends of the calls, flat, without any change of frequency, composite. When the call have two harmonically independent components, but they are emitted simultaneously, and frequency step. When the call have different frequency change appear as vertical steps on the spectrogram, but without an interruption in time. Ultrasonic mission, as previous speaker told us, is a consistent and very robust phenomenon during adult social interaction, both in males and females. And actually, it could be considered an index of social interest and also social motivation. And in male-female social interaction, as in these recordings, male USV can emit male can emit USV during courtship to maintain female proximity, to reduce the female aggression, and importantly, to facilitate the copulation. But also in female-female social interaction, female USV can facilitate the proximity between the resident and the intruder, so the resident female can acquire important social information about the intruder. BTBR mouse is an inbred strain of mice that display a lot of behavioral traits that are relevant to autism. And in male-female social interaction, in particular, BTBR males display at the lower level of a less number of vocalizations as compared with the control B6 mice, and also a lower level of sniffing duration as in association to BTBR to ultrasonic vocalizations. And also BTBR displayed a less number of vocalization and a lower level of sniffing duration during female-female social interaction, and also during the third social encounter that is male-male. So this data suggests that BTBR mouse model of autism resemble all the atypical social behavior that we have in subject in humans with autism. However, significant differences appear also when we compare the vocal repertoire. I mean, the emission of 10 different call categories that I show you before across different social interaction. And here in this slide, the pie graphs display the percentages of different call categories within each strain, and in particular during male, female, and male. And it seems that the BTBR mouse model use different call categories in comparison to B6 control because they have an increased number of a structured call in male, female, and male interaction. Why they actually prefer to emit upward and short calls in comparison to complex frequency step and two component emitted by control group in female. Moreover, we analyzed ultrasonic vocalization and social behavior emitted by synapsin mutants mice. Since synapsin genes, and in particular synapsin 1 and synapsin 2, have been recently associated with autism and also with epilepsy in human. And in fact, synapsin 1 and synapsin 2 emitted the less number of vocalization in comparison to mice and also a lower level of social investigation. The same happens for synapsin 2, a less number of vocalization in comparison to wild-type mice and a less level of sniffing duration. However, this non appear for synapsin 3 knockout because they emit the same number of vocalization and the same sniffing duration. Actually, the social deficits was also associated with the genotype differences in the use of specific call category, specifically in synapsin 2 knockout mice, since they prefer to emit short all in comparison to wild-type dead mice. This data suggests that the impairment in synapsin 1 is limited to the calling rate, just the number appear different. In synapsin 2, this socio-communicative deficit is extended to the vocal repertoire more in general. No differences in synapsin 3 knockout mice. In addition, BTBR calls smaller. We have measured also the number of vocalization during the neonatal phase, in particular at postnatal day 2, 4, 6, 8, and 12, when we separate the pups from the mother and siblings. And we can see here that BTBR pups mouse model of autism emitted significantly higher number of vocalization natal day 2, 4, 6, 8, and 12, and also these calls were of significantly longer duration than B6 mice. Also, we measured the peak frequency and the peak amplitude, and we have found that BTBR pups, in comparison to other three strain had an higher peak amplitude at postnatal day 6 and postnatal day 8 and an higher peak amplitude at postnatal day at all of postnatal day 2, 4, 6, 8, and 12. And this data seems to suggest us that BTBR pups called more loudly and more frequently when separated from their mother and siblings. And also they have a different vocal repertoire at postnatal day 8 because they prefer emitting a higher number of composite calls, as we can see here in the red color. As for BTBR PAPs, we also measured the ontogenetic profile in genetic mouse model of neurodevelopmental disorders, and we have found that they have always an altered ontogenetic profile during the 2 postnatal weeks. For example, Nopin neorexin mice prefer to emit a less number of vocalization postnatal day 8 in comparison to wild type, and at mice, Reeler mice prefer emit a higher number in comparison to Reeler knockout and at. And the same happens for synapsin model. In fact, synapsin 1 knockout mice emit a less number at postnatal day 4 in comparison to wild type, and synapsin 2 emitted a less number at postnatal day 8 in comparison to wild type, while at an increased number. No difference, we didn't find any difference in synapsin 3 mice. This data seems to confirm the adult ultrasonic vocalization in adult synapsin model. We also measured ultrasonic vocalization in orexin mutant pups, and they have a different vocal profile, specifically at postnatal day 12, when they prefer, knockout mice prefer to emit short calls in 81% in comparison to 44% of wild-type mice and 51% percent in het mice, confirming that knockout neorexin have a restricted and not complex vocal repertoire, as in other models of autism or neurodevelopmental conditions. This table summarizes all the genetic animal models of autism spectrum conditions that we have found in literature, in which USV have been analyzed, recorded, and analyzed in neonatal phase and adult phase, and analyzed from a quantitative and a qualitative point of view, and sometimes after treatment, pharmacological treatment, with the aim to restore the socio-communicative deficits. From a translational point of view, similarities have been found between mouse vocalization and human sound. And first of all, the anatomy of a vocal apparatus is similar between humans and mouse, but in general, rodents emit ultrasonic vocalization when there is an interaction between airflow and the upper vocal tract, specifically the structure that they have in the larynx. And in a similar manner, humans emit sound when the vocal cord in the larynx vibrate. Moreover, as for mice pups, in humans, the cry could be described by a different acoustic parameters, such as fundamental frequency and deformant frequency and amplitude. The fundamental frequency is the base frequency of human cry and is perceived as a pitch. However, formant frequency is a cluster of sound that emitted at particular frequency, and they are produced by a resonance in the vocal tract. And also in humans, the cry can be described from a qualitative point of view, described by specific shape of waves, so chevron, downward, flat, upward. My pubs, actually, USV pubs have been linked to the cries of human infants, particularly in the context of neurodevelopmental disorders like SD, as the ultrasonic vocalization pubs are an index of pup emotional and social motivation. Also, infant cry is one of the major affective social behaviors perceptible in humans' development because it acts as a communication for its capability to elicit response from caregiver. And in fact, from the literature, we know that cry patterns in infant with SD differ in different circumstances to typical developing infants or other infants with other neurodevelopmental conditions. So we can say that both acoustic and functional features of mice ultrasonic vocalization have been suggested to reflect the same purpose as infant cry. Moreover, autism can include impaired abilities to express emotion or respond to emotion of others. The speech provides a valuable mechanism for expressing emotion. So for us, studying melody or intonation of speech and the detailed spectrographic characteristic in mouse vocal models in mouse or also in general in rodents could be very useful. And some aspect of autistic speech incorporates all the three features of the diagnosis: repetitive behavior, deficits in their ability to express emotion, and deficit in social communication. And in Italy, we have already established the NIDA network for early identification of autism spectrum disorders, or in general neurodevelopmental condition, that it enrolls high-risk infants, that I mean siblings of children already diagnosed with autism, because they have a higher risk to develop autism or in general neurodevelopmental condition in comparison to general population, since we know siblings and their child with autism even partially share the same genetic protocol. So we are recording and analyze infant cry at 10 days and 6, 12, 11 and 20 weeks of age of infant at home, similar to the mice protocol. And with this analysis of cry characteristic, we would like to investigate potentially early marker of autism or neurodevelopmental conditions. And in conclusion, we can say key regulators of social behaviors are the fundamental regulators of social behaviors in different contexts in life. And in particular, USV analysis can be used to study how genes influence social communication and motivation in animal model of neurodevelopmental condition. And in particular, assessment of prosody along with other measures of social behavior are for us important from a translational point of view for application in mouse research of mental illness. And thank you for your attention.
So, do we have any questions? Yeah, we got. So, before Adam handles the microphone, I will have a question. In this setup with a newborn, did you use also like a movement analysis? For example, there is a general movement assessment of infants, and it is meant to discover some problems.
Yes, we measure motor behavior in pups, in mice, when we record ultrasonic vocalization, we remove the pup and put in a glass container, so we can also record the movement behavior. And we have found, especially for Leishmanian mutant pups and in orexin mutant pups, differences. They are a very, very motor delay. And also for human, we are recording cry at the same time, the general movements, and we are approaching the analysis, but we have just the preliminary results, and we have found a lot of delay. Actually, we have measured the general movements, but also the general movements are spontaneous behavior, but we have, and they are described visually from a trained professional. But we are using also the software to analyze the cinematic parameters, and we have found that high-risk infants that have autism diagnosis or a diagnosis of other neurodevelopmental condition have differences in these cinematic parameters. They move with a higher velocity, usually with another higher velocity, and with the repetitive behavior both for feet and hands. We are using actually the software to do this in infants and also in mice pup.
Thank you, Dr. Lynch. You can hear me. Is it keeping on speaking? Can you hear me or do you want me to know?
Yeah.
Sorry, it is very difficult to understand.
No.
Okay, I'm coming to this microphone if it's better. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes,
Okay,
it's
this is Sylvie speaking. I was, if I understand correctly, thank you for your talk. It was a lot of novel and interesting data and a very dedicated analysis. So, if I understand correctly, you're looking for an early marker of autism spectrum disorder in various models. So, in your analysis, did you follow the animals from the pup age where you analyze vocalization at different ages and to the adolescent and adult social interaction, or was it various different groups of animals that you tested?
In most of the animal models, they are different batch of mice. We analyze a set of pup mice, and then for adult mice, another set of mice. Actually, we didn't measure vocalization during adolescence.
Okay, so now I was wondering if you, for example, if you have a vocalization recorded in pups and if you follow these animals in adulthood, whether there is similarity or correlations between what you recorded in pups and whether it could be predictive of social behavior that you have at adulthood. That was to see whether there are early markers of these discrepancies in social interaction, for example.
Actually, we didn't do any detail about this correlation, just what we have show you with this
Okay.
talk.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Got a technical questions about the classification of the ultrasound, because I know that this is a lot of work. Yes, did you do it manually or use some software for classification?
Yes, the classification is very, very time consuming. We did this classification manually because we tried with different software, but it was not easy because the classification, even if we have the strict uses I show you to classify each one, it was not possible with the software. Actually, we would like to use a machine learning approach to see if it works better than a software.
Thank you very much. Yes, tomorrow we're gonna have a lecture about the classification. So we're gonna see if it's possible to reduce the time of.
Yes, because it's very time consuming. I know.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.